we knew you were in town. We got together and we have talked. We've known each other for a few years. And I'm sure that most people around the country, who, unless they have not read the paper, have realized, and it was in headlines from other papers yesterday, that you have stepped out of a motion picture that you were going to do with Elia Kazan, The Arrangement, for a very important reason. And I thought you might like to mention why, and then we'll pick up from there.
Yeah, it was a very tough decision to make because I can't think of a director that's better than Gadge Kazan. To me, he is the best director. And I've looked forward, during the intervening years since I worked with him last, to working with him again. It's, of course, the story of the year, perhaps the last 2 years. And I was wanted to do it more than anything. And King got shot. And I sat in front of a television set, and I wondered what it meant to me that he's dead, and that he died, and his last act was trying to get a 15-cent wage increase for garbage men, and that he was hauled to his grave by two mules on a rickety cart, and that on his tombstone was written, "Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, free at last." And in his last speech on television, as I watched the news reports come over, it showed his last words the night before. And he said that he'd been to the mountain and that he'd seen the promised land. And he said, "I don't know if I'm going to get there with you, but it doesn't matter about me, because I know we're going to get there. Mine eyes have seen the glory and the coming of the Lord." And he was shot dead the next day. And I thought, somehow this has got to matter somewhere. And if we don't, all the citizens, do something that is a person-to-person contribution, I don't think that that we're really going to have any place to come home to if we do get a job. I felt that it was there was just nothing that I could do in terms of what I know and what I see and what I feel. I couldn't think of any other alternative rather than to make my time, my energies, and my money fully available to do what I can as an individual to rectify the situation we're in.
You think it rather paradoxical that he seemed to accomplish by dying something that he might not have accomplished, maybe in time, but since his death. And you sometimes feel that maybe there's going to be a period of 2 or 3 weeks where everybody is going to say, yes, it was terrible, and it made everybody conscious of it, but really, maybe things won't change unless, you know, the time becomes...
I don't think they will, Johnny. I think that that nothing is really going to change unless I do it, unless the trombone player does it, unless the guy sitting and watching the television with a beer can does something about it. The president appointed a rather conservative group of men to investigate the reasons for civil disorders. And it came out in this book I brought along tonight, which might be of interest. It's called The Report of the National Advisory Commission on Civil Disorders. It's a Bantam book. You can get it anywhere. But it tells in chapter and verse the situation we're in, why we're in it, and why the black people can't get up off their knees. And it points very specifically to the white man and his feeling about the black man. It points to racism and discrimination in its most subtle forms and its most cruel and blatant forms. And that's where it is. That's the Bible. The president commissioned these people to find out. They did find out, and it's before us now. I don't think there's 1 in 100,000 Americans that have ever read it. But it isn't enough to talk anymore. It isn't enough to shake our fingers. We have to do something. We have to get up our money. We have to give our time. we have to give our hearts, and we must be involved in a person-to-person program. Fundamentally, because now that King is dead, many people, I think, and you've certainly felt it too, that there is the vacuum formed. And
I think a lot of people are worried that maybe the militants might rush in and try to fill that vacuum.
Well, that's where it's going to go. And I think that we've got one chance. I was talking with Walter Reuther on the way to King's funeral in the march, and Walter Reuther said that we've got one last chance as white people to straighten things around in this country. And if we don't do it soon, and if we don't do it massively, then it's going to be Armageddon, it's going to be guns, it's going to be thousands of people killed, it will be internment camps. We will have reduced ourselves as a nation and our stature as a people, importantly. And so the only thing I could think to come up with was trying to get a program where people would contribute no less than 1% of their entire year's earnings to the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, which was King's organization, to further his philosophy and to further his works, to carry on his good works in the name of nonviolence and with the help of his beautiful wife, Mrs. King. I think there is where we have to throw our full support. I think the black people are losing heart and belief, whatever residual of faith that the white man was going to treat them equally and fairly is now running out. And I dread to think what's going to happen. But we now have to do it in a person-to-person way.
I think something that people, I don't want to interrupt you,
yeah,
when I talk here, I think something that people don't think of, the more the other person benefits economically and socially, the more everybody will benefit in the long run.
Well, it has
to better everybody, not only them. That's not part of it. It's got to do more for everybody in the long run, because
exactly
the more you up anybody else, the more you're going to be up along the way.
That's right. That's what Reuther said. He said that it costs us an enormous amount of money to keep black people in the position that they're in. You see, what will happen if we do nothing? People will be angrier and angrier and angrier. Frustrations will rise and tensions will mount and violence will occur, because black people have been promised help. That help has not been forthcoming. At the same time, as that tension and violence rises, there will be a white withdrawal, so that people will be in fear and anger on both sides. They will be forming what you might say is polarization. A polarization will be formed, and the only people that are going to be in the center are people with guns.
Well, there's no way this country can exist with two races apart.
It can exist, but we're not going to exist the way we'd like to exist that way.
No, I said it really can't exist in the long run.
No. I think that we do have one chance left, one shot in the barrel, and the time is running out. But, so I got together with some people, and we decided that we were going to give up our time and money and use our time for action rather than non-action, rather than just jaw action. We were going to do something in a very specific way. What we hope to do is to try to get the Congress to pass these laws, to get the legislators to pass the laws that have to be passed in order for us to come together in peace and unity and productiveness. But that's going to take a certain amount of time. But I might at this point give you some very encouraging news.
I know you've talked to a certain number of people all in our business already about this.
In the last day and a half, or actually today and yesterday, I've talked to a number of people. I got one hesitation and no refusals. Les Crane, Rudy Telly, Merv Griffin, Joey Bishop, Barbara Streisand, Joanne Woodward, Zev Putterman, Paul Newman, Alex Cohen, who's the producer of the Emmy Awards, and Drew Pearson, who I just left on the phone a few minutes ago, are all willing to give up 1% of their annual salary and send it as a tribute to Dr. Martin Luther King and his foundation. I'm going to give up 10% of my earnings for the year, and there's no limit. We don't feel that it's right that we should accept anything less than 1%. But that isn't enough. Money isn't enough. Money will buy us time. But programs and someone said you can't legislate hate in the human heart. It's there. But we have to ask ourselves. I mean, this report clearly indicates that the black people have not been able to pick themselves up by their bootstraps because of white feelings against them. And we, all of us, have to find out what is that? Why do we feel that way? What are these reasons? And the first time you talk to a racist, when I say racist, I'm not talking like a bigot like Wallace or, you know, something like that. But if you talk to someone who is a racist, they don't know it. They don't feel it. I think all of us, if we really mine the deepest areas of our feelings, we'll find maybe some trace of that. And we've got to find that. We've got to root it out, and we've got to go ahead in terms of action and feeling. And primarily, that's
a positive commitment.
Yes, a positive.
When you called me, we talked the day before yesterday. You asked me, and you explained this, and I said at that time, and I said I didn't want to be wishy-washy. And you said, I don't know. I guess I wanted, you know, to hear more about what was going to happen. And as you know me well enough, I think. I said, if I do anything, I certainly did not want to do it, you know, for publicity's sake. Right. And at the same time, if you don't get the message out, I guess, and do something in public, you are committed, but sometimes you're committed anonymously. So when you asked me, would I be willing, and I told you this afternoon, I says, I'll tell you tonight. Now, I would be very happy to be a part of this, because I think, truly, it is time to stand up and be counted in this country where you stand, rather than just talking about it. Because, it's pretty strange. If we cannot learn to live together in this country, I don't know how, in hell's sake, we are ever going to learn to live with anybody else in the world or understand the Asian or anybody else if we can't understand the people who are here. So I would be very happy to give you tonight, and as I say, I would prefer not to do this, but I'm doing it only as a help, because anything that will get this thing going, I would be delighted. I would be happy to give you a check, and I told you about this before the show, for 1% of my income for the year, for exactly what you want. And I hope it does some good.
It's beautiful.
I think you're home.